Chapter 5 The Subtle Serpent, Section 8 First of all, I must mention that for the last two or three minutes Lizaveta Nikolaevna had seemed to be possessed by a new impulse. She was whispering something hurriedly to her mother and to Mavriky Nikolaevitch, who bent down to listen. Her face was agitated, but at the same time it had a look of resolution. At last she got up from her seat in evident haste to go away, and hurried her mother, whom Mavriky Nikolaevitch began helping up from her low chair. But it seemed they were not destined to get away without seeing everything to the end. Shatov, who had been forgotten by everyone in his corner, not far from Lizaveta Nikolaevna, and who did not seem to know himself why he went on sitting there, got up from his chair and walked without haste, with resolute steps, right across the room to Nikolay Vsevolodovitch, looking him straight in the face. The latter noticed him approaching at some distance and faintly smiled, but when Shatov was close to him, he left off smiling. When Shatov stood still facing him with his eyes fixed on him and without uttering a word, everyone suddenly noticed it and there was a general hush. Pyotr Stepanovitch was the last to cease speaking. Liza and her mother were standing in the middle of the room. So passed 5 seconds. The look of haughty astonishment was followed by one of anger on Nikolay Vsevolodovitch's face. He scowled, and suddenly Shatov swung his long heavy arm and with all his might struck him a blow in the face. Nikolay Vsevolodovitch staggered violently. Shatov struck the blow in a peculiar way, not at all after the conventional fashion, if one may use such an expression. It was not a slap with the palm of his hand, but a blow with the whole fist, and it was a big, heavy, bony fist covered with red hairs and freckles. If the blow had struck the nose, it would have broken it. But it hit him on the cheek and struck the left corner of the lip and the upper teeth, from which blood streamed at once. I believe there was a sudden scream, perhaps Varvara Petrovna screamed, that I don't remember, because there was a dead hush again. The whole scene did not last more than 10 seconds, however. Yet a very great deal happened in those seconds. I must remind the reader again that Nikolay Vsevolodovitch's was one of those natures that know nothing of fear. At a duel, he could face the pistol of his opponent with indifference and could take aim and kill with brutal coolness. If anyone had slapped him in the face, I should have expected him not to challenge his assailant to a duel, but to murder him on the spot. He was just one of those characters and would have killed the man, knowing very well what he was doing and without losing his self-control. I fancy, indeed, that he never was liable to those fits of blind rage which deprive a man of all power of reflection. Even when overcome with intense anger, as he sometimes was, he was always able to retain complete self-control, and therefore to realize that he would certainly be sent to penal servitude for murdering a man not in a duel. Nevertheless, he'd have killed anyone who insulted him, and without the faintest hesitation. I have been studying Nikolay Vsevolodovitch of late, and through special circumstances I know a great many facts about him now at the time I write. I should compare him, perhaps, with some gentlemen of the past, of whom legendary traditions are still perceived among us. We are told, for instance, about the Decembrist L, that he was always seeking for danger, that he reveled in the sensation, and that it had become a craving of his nature, that in his youth he had rushed into duels for nothing, that in Siberia he used to go to kill bears with nothing but a knife, that in Siberian forests he liked to meet with runaway convicts, who are, I may observe in passing, more formidable than bears. There is no doubt that these legendary gentlemen were capable of a feeling of fear, and even to an extreme degree, perhaps, or they would have been a great deal quieter, and a sense of danger would never have become a physical craving with them. But the conquest of fear was what fascinated them. The continual ecstasy of vanquishing, and the consciousness that no one could vanquish them, was what attracted them. The same L struggled with hunger for some time before he was sent into exile, and toiled to earn his daily bread simply because he did not care to comply with the requests of his rich father, which he considered unjust. So his conception of struggle was many-sided, and he did not prize stoicism and strength of character only in duels and bear fights. But many years have passed since those times, and the nervous, exhausted, complex character of the men of today is incompatible with the craving for those direct and unmixed sensations which were so sought after by some restlessly active gentlemen of the good old days. Nikolay Vsyevolodovitch would perhaps have looked down on L. and have called him a boastful cock-a-hoop coward. It's true he wouldn't have expressed himself aloud. Stavrogin would have shot his opponent in a duel, and would have faced a bear if necessary, and would have defended himself from a brigand in the forest as successfully and as fearlessly as L. But it would be without the slightest thrill of enjoyment, languidly, listlessly, even with ennui, and entirely from unpleasant necessity. In anger, of course, there has been a progress compared with L., even compared with Lermontov. There was perhaps more malignant anger in Nikolay Vsyevolodovitch than in both put together, but it was a calm, cold, if one may so say, reasonable anger, and therefore the most revolting and most terrible possible. I repeat again, I considered him then, and I still consider him, now that everything is over, a man who, if he received a slap in the face or any equivalent insult, would be certain to kill his assailant at once, on the spot, without challenging him. Yet in the present case what happened was something different and amazing. He had scarcely regained his balance after being almost knocked over in this humiliating way, and the horrible, as it were, sodden thud of the blow in the face had scarcely died away in the room when he seized Shatov by the shoulders with both hands, but at once, almost at the same instant, pulled both hands away and clasped them behind his back. He did not speak, but looked at Shatov and turned as white as his shirt. But strange to say, the light in his eyes seemed to die out. 10 seconds later, his eyes looked cold, and I'm sure I'm not lying, calm. Only he was terribly pale. Of course, I don't know what was passing within the man. I saw only his exterior. It seems to me that if a man should snatch up a bar of red-hot iron and hold it tight in his hand to test his fortitude, and after struggling for 10 seconds with insufferable pain, end by overcoming it, such a man would, I fancy, go through something like what Nikolay Vsyevolodovitch was enduring during those 10 seconds. Shatov was the first to drop his eyes, and evidently because he was unable to go on facing him. Then he turned slowly and walked out of the room, but with a very different step. He withdrew quietly, with peculiar awkwardness, with his shoulders hunched, his head hanging as though he were inwardly pondering something. I believe he was whispering something. He made his way to the door carefully, without stumbling against anything or knocking anything over. He opened the door a very little way and squeezed through, almost sideways. As he went out, his shock of hair standing on end at the back of his head was particularly noticeable. Then first of all one fearful scream was heard. I saw Lizaveta Nikolaevna seize her mother by the shoulder and Mavriky Nikolaevitch by the arm and make two or three violent efforts to draw them out of the room, but she suddenly uttered a shriek and fell full length on the floor fainting. I can hear the thud of her head on the carpet to this day. End of part 1 of The Possessed.